The second type is a finite impulse response filter, or in short, FIR filter. The filter structure is depicted here. So you have only a feed forward branch. It looks kind of similar like the IIR filter, but the feed back branch is missing. Yeah, so just have a feed forward branch here with the filter taps. All outputs are summed up and they form the output signal. But the feedback network here at behind the output is missing. And this has some special consequences for FIR filters. FIR filters have always a finite length output and finite length impulse response. So this is where the name comes from, and thereby they are always stable. But now let's first have a look at the mathematics. So to get more information, please have a look at the lecture notes. And first, here's the transfer function. It is looks quite the same like the transfer function of an infinite impulse response filter, but the feedback branch is missing. So what remains is the sum here of the feed forward taps. And now this is the impulse response. And you can also derive it from the general formula of the infinite impulse response filter, and then just set all the feedback coefficients to zero. And what remains would then be the formula of the finite impulse response filter. But here you see a special notation. You see directly that the impulse response is it's just composed of the coefficients here of the filter taps. Yeah, so there's a direct connection between the filter tap coefficients and the impulse response. Where does it come from? Imagine that you have a Delta Dirac pulse, and now this pulse is passed here through this chain of delay elements, and yeah, so actually the one here from the Dirac delta function is only present once at a time here after each filtered delay element. So if for time n equals zero, the one is here, and any other output of the delay element is zero. So for n equals zero, one multiplied by b zero is the output. That's correct. And now, in the next sample period, a zero follows here because the Dirac delta function is zero everywhere else, but this point is one. One multiplied by b1 is b1 at the output. Okay, and this goes for any other delay tap here. And when the Dirac delta function is at this point and the next sample period follows, then all inputs to the coefficients here are zero, and the signal is zero again. Yeah, so this is how this impulse response is generated. So the impulse response of infinite impulse response filter can be directly read from the filter coefficients here, the tap coefficients. So now let's have a look at the stability of FIR filters. We can also do a pole zero analysis. So this is the transfer function of FIR filters, and now we can we have here a Z power minus I, and we for the pole zero analysis we have to make a positive exponent here, and so we can rewrite this transfer function, and we see here that all poles are zero. So there are a number of poles, and the number of poles equals the number of filter taps, so the number of delay elements in our FIR filter, but all poles are zero, and the zeros of the filter can be somewhere else, but it doesn't matter because all poles are located within the unit circle, and our FIR filter system is always stable. So what does it mean in the time domain? So here you see that our FIR filter consists of a feed-forward network only, and the feedback network is missing. And now you give a direct delta pulse to the input of the filter system, and now we see directly the filter coefficients here, and let's assume we have a filter of the order 4, and after that the output is 0 again. So it is always stable because at some point the output is just 0, and it cannot grow to infinity like an IIR filter. And here the length of the impulse response here is the filter order. So now you might wonder why we have infinite impulse response filters and finite impulse response filters. Why do we not only choose FIR filters because they are always stable, so you don't have to make up your mind and check for instabilities and so on? That would be an argument to choose an FIR filter, but to get the same filter characteristic you would need more delay elements, so you need a higher order, and higher order and higher greater number of delay elements increase your cost of the system. So what do I mean with filter characteristics? For example, imagine that you want to implement a low pass filter in the digital domain, and it should have a special characteristic. So for example, this band where the filter curve drops to zero should be of a certain length, and so you can perfectly achieve this with an IIR filter of order, let's say, 3, but if you choose to implement the same characteristic with an FIR filter, you probably need a filter order of, let's say, 9, this is just an example. Yeah, so you need to add more delay elements, and each delay element costs memory, costs processing power, and so on. Or for example, if you imagine that you have to implement the FAR filter with digital circuits, so logic gates and so on, you need more logic gates, or in software you need more RAM, and so everything comes with a cost. So this is why you find infinite imports response filters quite often out there, because they give you the same performance like FIR filters, but with much less filter delay elements with a much lower order. Yeah, so again, you need to find a compromise between the properties of FIR filters and IIR filters. And if you choose an IIR filter, you always need to check stability. And the check for stability can be a hard job for IIR filters, because you can calculate everything in theory, so you now have the mathematical basis to analyze the stability, but a digital signal processing system is again not ideal. So you have a CPU, a processor, you write software, and you know that you have to deal with floating point numbers. So I don't know if you are familiar with programming computer software. You have some data types for floating point operations, and but you can also choose fixed point numbers. It doesn't matter, but all these numbers only have a limited precision. So it might happen that for an IIR filter, your pole is very close to the unit circle, and it would work if you analyze it mathematically. But now, then you write a C program and you use the data type float for the signal, and now you have just a limited precision of 32 bits. And now what happens is that your system poles now shift out of the unit circle, and then your system becomes unstable. Yeah, so you always need to carefully check your system for stability if you do not use an FIR filter.